So until now, we focused on our basic five-stage pipeline. And now I'm going to extend that pipeline so it can handle other kinds of instructions as well. Okay, so just as before, we have an instruction fetch stage. Then we have the decode and register read stage. And now after this, depending on the kind of instruction, you will take one of many different paths. Okay, so if you are a simple add instruction which uses the simple ALU unit, then you will take this path over here. You will do your add, and then when you finish, you will come down over here. Okay, I'm going to deviate slightly from the textbook and I'm going to remove this data memory stage because not every instruction has to go through the data memory stage, right? So the add instruction does its math and then it moves to the register write stage. If you are a load or a store, then you take a different path where you first do an add to compute your address, then you go into the data memory access, and then you go into this register write stage. If you are a multiply instruction, then you enter the seven-stage pipeline of your own. So it takes seven cycles to finish a multiply operation, and then you again go into the register write stage. If you are a floating point add operation, then you go along this stage, which takes four cycles, and then back into register write. Similar, a divide takes 25 cycles in this case. Okay, so now I have these many different instructions that can be handled, and each instruction is being handled by a slightly different pipeline, each with different lengths. Okay, so this gives me much more capability, but it also introduces all kinds of problems. Okay, let's take the simplest problem over here. Let's say that I have a load instruction followed by an add instruction. Okay, the load starts in cycle one. Okay, and it's going to do its register write. So you do the fetch in cycle one, you do the decode in cycle two, up here in cycle three, then cycle four, and then the register write in cycle five. The add comes right behind the load, so it starts in cycle two, but it goes through a shorter pipeline, right? So you're here in cycle two, three, four, and then up here. So cycle five, you will do your register write. So now your register write stage is being oversubscribed. There are multiple instructions finishing in the same cycle because of the fact that instructions are starting at different times and going through pipelines that have different lengths. So because of that, it's possible that a whole bunch of instructions finish at the same time and they're all trying to do register write at the same time. Okay, so this is a structural hazard because you are essentially competing for resources at the register file. And the best way to deal with it is to just have more write ports. So for example, my design could choose to have, you know, four register write ports. And this allows me to finish up to four instructions in any given cycle. Okay, so that's problem number one. Next, let's look at what else can go wrong. Okay, so we've already dealt with this issue with multiple writes to the register file. The next problem is called a raw hazard. Okay, what is this? So when we discussed data dependencies earlier, I said you have a producing instruction which maybe writes something into R1, and then you have a consumer which reads something from R1. So at that time I just called this a data dependence and I didn't kind of expand this into more details. Now I'm ready to call this a read after write hazard. So this is a read after write hazard. That is, I'm reading from a register entry after the write into that register entry has happened. And because this is a read after write operation on a given register R1, I have to make sure that the consumer comes after the producer. Okay. Now, in my design over here, in this design, I have these really long latency instructions. So I could have a divide which writes something into R1, and then I could have a simple add instruction that is reading R1. Because the divide takes 25 cycles to finish, or actually longer than 25 cycles because it's 25 plus the other three stages, since it takes so long to finish, the add ends up getting stalled, right? So the decode stage will say, oh, you know, you need R1. R1 is not going to be ready until 24 cycles later. So you just have to sit here in the decode stage until R1 is made available. Okay, so because of this read after write dependence, the second instruction gets stuck in this decode stage. And because instructions move through the pipeline in program order, or at least they move through these two stages in program order, every instruction after this add also gets stuck right behind it. Okay, the other instructions can't skip past and jump into their pipelines because every instruction has to go through this decode stage in program order. Okay, so because of this raw dependence, because of this raw hazard, the subsequent instructions are all being stalled. So if you have long latency instructions like a 7-cycle multiply or a 4-cycle floating point add or a 25-cycle divide, you end up introducing several stalls in your pipeline, and that hurts performance. Okay, so things were not too bad when I had a simple 5-stage pipeline, but as I have long latency instructions, things start to get worse. Okay, so that's the problem with frequent read-after-write hazards. Okay, now let's look at the next kind of hazard, a write-after-write hazard. So what is this? So if I were to write something into R1, and a later instruction also were to write something into R1, this is called a write-after-write hazard. Okay, what it means is, if there are two instructions that are both trying to write into R1, you cannot reorder these two. And the reason is, you could have something down over here which is trying to read R1. Okay, so if the first instruction was, say, trying to write 20 into R1, and the second instruction was trying to write 50 into R1, when you read from R1, the programmer expects that you will return the value 50. But if for some reason these two instructions finished out of program order, let's say that this was the divide, and let's say this was the add. Since the divide takes a really long time, it's possible that the 20 gets written after the 50. If this happens, then what you'll end up reading from R1 is actually 20. Right? So this is a problem that is introduced by my new pipeline over here, because things are finishing out of order, right? So even though instructions move through instruction fetch and decode in program order, there is out of order completion of instructions. Because instructions are completing out of order, this write to R1 could happen after this write to R1, which means that other instructions that come later which try to read R1 will end up getting this value, when in fact they should be getting this value. Okay, this was not a problem in our simple 5-stage pipeline, because in our 5-stage pipeline, you had in-order execution throughout, right? You even had in-order completion of instructions. So you were guaranteed that this write to R1 would happen first, followed by this write to R1. Okay, it's only in this new design that, because writes are being reordered, you are possibly violating a write-after-write dependence. Okay, so now let's look at this example in a little bit more detail. And unfortunately, I've cluttered this slide too much, so I'll write it again. So there's a write into R1, and instead a problem happens when somebody else writes to R1, and there's a read of R1 over here. And this finishes in, say, cycle 30, and this finishes in cycle 10. Okay, and let's say that this read of R1 is happening in cycle 40. Which means you will end up getting this result and not this result. Okay, so you know it's possible that you know this need not happen. If there was an instruction in between which tried to read R1, then you could avoid a problem because of this write after write hazard. And let's see how. Okay, since this instruction needs the value being produced by R1, the decode stage will recognize that R1 is not yet ready. It's going to be ready in cycle 30. And it would force this instruction to stall until R1 was actually made available. Since R1 is stalled, every instruction behind it is also going to get stalled, because you have to go through the decode stage in program order. Right? These instructions can't jump ahead of an earlier instruction that is stuck in decode. Okay, so when this instruction gets stalled, everybody else behind it gets stalled. The write into R1 happens in cycle 30. Then these other guys get to move ahead. And so in that case, this write to R1 is forced to finish after this earlier write to R1. Okay, and most of the time you will find an intermediate instruction that tries to read R1, right? Because I produce a result in R1. I obviously had some intent behind producing that result. I expected to consume that result, right? People don't write into a register and then never read from that value. Okay, so the fact that I wrote something into R1 means that a consumer is not very far behind. So most of the time you will see this dependent instruction, and that automatically handles this write after write hazard situation. Okay, but in a few cases, it's possible that this intermediate read of R1 does not happen. Okay, maybe you go along a branch path, right? So maybe the then part reads the value R1 and the else part does not read the value R1. So in some cases, it's possible that you may encounter the next write to R1 without ever encountering this consumer instruction. So you still have to handle this case where you have a potential write after write hazard. And the way we are going to handle it in this case is to add more intelligence in my decode stage. So my decode stage, as I said, has a pretty good idea of what has happened prior to this instruction. So it knows that there is a previous write to R1 which is not going to complete until cycle 30. Okay, and so if it encounters this write to R1, it says, hey, hang on, I think you will finish pretty quickly if I let you move forward. And I have to make sure that you do your write after the earlier instruction finishes its write. So this instruction then gets stalled, and every instruction after it gets stalled right behind it. Okay, so we're dealing with write after write hazards by detecting this situation at decode time and stalling the instruction that is performing the second write to that register entry. Okay, so this is also going to slow your program down, because this is, you know, yet another reason to stall an instruction and lower my IPC.